Welcome, everyone. Welcome, everyone, to our morning worship at St. Albans. Our opening hymn is number 48, O Day of Radiant Gladness.
Rick, you're muted. Rick, can you unmute?
Sorry, folks, I've just sort of lost my screen for a second. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has dawned upon you. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
O God, you have taken to yourself the Blessed Virgin Mary, mother of your incarnate Son and our Savior. Grant that we, who have been redeemed by his blood, may share with her the glory of your eternal kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Our first reading is from Isaiah 61. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God. For God has clothed me with the garments of salvation, has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations. Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And the psalm appointed for today is Psalm 34. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall ever be in my mouth. I will glory in the Lord. Let the humble hear and rejoice. Proclaim with me the greatness of the Lord. Let us exalt the Lord's name together. I sought the Lord, and the Lord answered me and delivered me out of all my terror. Look upon the Lord and be radiant, and let not your faces be ashamed. I called in my affliction, and the Lord heard me and saved me from all my troubles. The angel of the Lord encompasses those who fear it, and he will deliver them. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are they who trust in him. Fear the Lord, you that are his saints, for those who fear him lack nothing.
A reading from Galatians. When the fullness of time had come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as children. And because you are children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a child. And if a child, then also an heir through God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia. Greetings, O favored one. The Lord is with you. The Holy Spirit will come upon you. Alleluia.
Becky, you may have to read this. I completely lost my screen here.
Do you want me to do it, Becky? The Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord
Christ. Mary said, my soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. For he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on, all generations will call me blessed. For the mighty one has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Good morning. Today is the 10th Sunday after Pentecost, but we are celebrating the feast of St. Mary the Virgin, which is actually on the church calendar for tomorrow, August 15th. August 15th was chosen as the feast day because it is the day on which the Mother of Jesus has been honored for about 1600, maybe 1700 years. It is hard sometimes to come to terms with St. Mary the Virgin. I think the reason is that we do not really think about sainthood anymore. We've lost the knack of figuring out what saints are. So we give the Mother of Jesus a kind of nondescript name, St. Mary the Virgin. We recite Mary's hymn, the Magnificat, yet again, and having done our duty, we move on. But if we take seriously the line in the Apostles' Creed about the communion of saints, we have to reclaim the idea of sainthood. We can start on this in two ways. First, we can consider how Mary is, in fact, the one most exceptionally important human in the history of our salvation. Second, we have to begin to see ourselves as saints. Mary has a number of names that relate to her, I think, a little better than St. Mary the Virgin. She is also known as Our Lady, the Blessed Virgin Mary, our Blessed Mother, and in the Orthodox Church, the God-bearer. Throughout history, she has been an inspiration. For example, there are the great cathedrals of Chartres and Notre Dame, and the marvelous Salisbury Cathedral in England is formally known as the Cathedral Church of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Mary has also inspired warmth. I think here of the devotion to Our Lady of Guadalupe, to the intensity of Lourdes, even to the impromptu shrine at the corner of Platform Bridge Road in the Point Reyes Petaluma Highway in Marin. The shrine has not one, but two statues of Mary, and it's crowded to bursting with plastic and real flowers. And Mary is deeply and naturally connected with Jesus. My mother automatically made the connection without thinking. When I told her that my daughter was pregnant with her first child, she said, "May her baby be as pure and beautiful as our Blessed Mother's." The point is that Mary was wrapped in a beautiful marvel. She gave birth to Jesus and therefore was the instrument of the incarnation. God chose her particularly, and he chose regular pregnancy, hard labor, the messiness of birth and motherhood to come into direct contact with us. If you think about it, Mary is, in fact, the great woman of the Bible. She is actually the greatest solely human person in the Bible. Well, I dare say for us Christians, she might be the greatest of all people. Just read over today's amazing collect. O God, you have taken to yourself the Blessed Virgin Mary, mother of your incarnate Son. And so maybe August 15th should be International Women's Day. Mary's experiences blend with our experiences. That is, she makes us think about our own sainthood. In his gospel, from the narrative of the Annunciation to the Visitation to the presentation in the temple and beyond, Luke, to my mind, is comparing and contrasting Mary with the great people of the Bible and how they responded to God's call to each of them. I'm looking at three men of the Bible here. They are Abraham, who is really the father of us all, and Moses, and the prophet Elijah, who both appeared with Jesus in the Transfiguration. Each of these men reacted to God's call in different ways. Abraham simply believed, and then he fretted and worried for years about getting a son. Moses was dragged kicking and screaming to do the job God wanted him to do, and then took up an immense administrative task that consumed his life. Elijah kept on responding and standing up for God through deep exhaustion and fear and depression. In her call, Mary seems remarkably wide awake when the angel comes to her. She listens, and then she asks the relevant and very practical question about sex and conception. When she got the answer about the Holy Spirit, she was satisfied. She said, "Behold the handmaid of the Lord." But in our terms, she was saying, "Okay, let's do it." But Mary and Abraham and Moses and Elijah had to do a lot more than be present when called. They also had to act and to endure. After the Visitation and the Magnificat, Mary ended up giving birth in a stable. And I am guessing that she did not have a proper midwife, and that the stable was not like the creches in our churches at Christmas time. She and Joseph too, let's be fair, raised Jesus as he grew in wisdom and grace. At the presentation in the temple, Simeon makes sure that Mary realizes that her baby will be a source of sorrow for her, that a sword will pierce her heart. Unbelievably and ghastly, she is at the crucifixion of her own son. Can we imagine? And Jesus expresses his love and concern for her by making sure that John takes her as his mother. She is present with the apostles after Jesus's death, as Acts tells us, the book of Acts. And by inference, she is present at Pentecost when she must have received the Holy Spirit for a second time. So what about our own sainthood? How do we and Mary share companionship? Well, we have all received a call, our own annunciation. It is right in front of our eyes and right in our ears, at least every Sunday. It's in the messages of the Gospels and the appearance of the kingdom. We can hear it in the situations we face every day. The grocery clerk, the other people in the line, the person who is hogging the ranger's time at a national park. I venture to say that each of us in quiet moments, or when we pause for a second, have felt the call in our hearts, in our very bones. And guess what? Each of us has already answered the call. That is why we are sitting where we are right now. Our calls are individualized and special to each of us. But no matter where we fit in the spectrum of the great calls of the Bible, no matter how we'd like to compare ourselves, we each have our own calls because we have our own lives. The call of Mary was her call, not ours, but we share with her the difficulty of living on earth. In company with Mary, we saints do not have easy lives. We have to endure pain, sorrow, and fear. We feel sometimes that God is not present. We can have even our moments of peevishness, our moments of nastiness. I suggest that this is the real context of the Magnificat, which we heard again today in the gospel reading. Mary is speaking or singing or prophesying in the first flush of her happiness. Shortly afterwards, she is told that a sword will pierce her heart. And later on, she goes on to witness her child's crucifixion. We saints do not have easy lives. Yet, I think that the Magnificat remains the foundation of Mary's life. She knows that God is with her, or at least she feels he was with her once at any given moment. And she must have said the Magnificat over and over throughout her life, sometimes just to get through things. My soul magnifies the Lord. I am chosen, I am called, I am special, I am loved. And so we should hold hard onto her song in our own sainthood. Because sainthood is when we grab at and hold on to the mystery, the paradox of love. Jesus, help us in all our trials and our joys. Help us find you in our hearts and in our bones. O Mary, be our companion in faith. Amen.
Together, let us affirm our faith in these words.
We believe in God, the Creator, by whom every person in heaven and earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, creator, redeemer, and sustainer. Amen.
Trusting in God's extraordinary love, let us come nearer to the Holy One in prayer.
Arise, O God, and sustain your church. We pray for all who dedicate their lives to serving your people. Renew our commitment to our siblings in faith around the globe, and bless the work of our ecumenical and interfaith partners. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Arise, O God, and sustain your creation. We pray for all places affected by natural disasters. Transform the devastation of floods and fires into fertile ground for new life and growth. Fill heaven and earth with your life-giving spirit. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Arise, O God, and sustain the nations. We pray for all elected officials. Kindle in them a desire to administer your justice. Strengthen the resolve to defend those who are vulnerable and stand publicly against all forms of oppression. Merciful God, arise, O God, and sustain those who are oppressed. We pray for people harmed by discrimination in all its forms. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Arise, O God, and sustain this assembly. We pray for this community, celebrating with those who rejoice and weeping with those who weep. In our joy and in our tears, be near us. Please unmute and offer your own petitions.
For Melody.
Amen.
Fran.
Amen.
For Lee.
Amen. Amen.
Nancy.
Amen.
Amen.
Adam, who's receiving radiation therapy for cancer of the tongue, having a really tough time.
Amen.
For the farm workers marching to have the right to vote in private to organize their unions.
Amen.
Amen.
In 100 degree weather for 24 days.
Mm. For Simone.
Amen.
Amen.
For Barbara, who has tested negative for COVID, finally.
Amen.
Amen.
For Janet and Patricia.
Amen.
Amen. Students and teachers returning to school.
Amen.
Amen.
Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, we remember the saints who have gone before us. May we run with perseverance the race set before us until we find rest in you. Please unmute and name those you wish to remember.
Ron and for Jenny.
Amen.
For my parents.
Amen. Amen.
For Father Andrew Kulnegy.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Jake and Betsy Roke.
Amen.
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 For Bob.
Amen. Amen.
For Judy.
Amen.
Amen.
For Jamie.
Amen.
Amen.
For John and all his travelers.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Receive the prayers of your children, merciful God, and hold us forever in your steadfast love. Through Jesus Christ, our holy wisdom. Amen.
Amen.
As Christ taught us, we now pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, in choosing the Virgin Mary to be the mother of your Son, you made known your gracious regard for the poor, the lowly, and the despised. Grant us grace to receive your word in humility, and so to be made one with your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Well, everyone, are there any birthdays? Let's start with birthdays.
Any yes.
Celebrate? Yes, yes.
Yes. Great. It's my dear son Nicholas's birthday today.
All right.
Yeah.
It's actually my birthday today.
Oh. Yay.
Okay. Who's speaking? I can't see the.
Ruth.
Ruth.
My brother's
Thank you.
My brother David's birthday was July 11th.
David?
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm off. We're in August. Wasn't thinking.
Okay. Well, we can celebrate it anyway.
Yeah.
Lori, it's Catherine. It's Catherine Ann. I have a dear friend whose birthday is today, Judy.
Judy.
And I have a grandson whose birthday is Tuesday. His name is Duke.
Duke. All right.
Duke. My daughter, April, is her birthday this month.
All right.
Henry's second birthday is tomorrow. So
I'm sorry, say that again.
Yeah, Henry, my son's second birthday is tomorrow.
Oh, all right.
Happy day.
Yeah. Wonderful. Anybody else? No? Okay. How about travelers?
Well, we're going to make a very quick trip down to Pismo Beach for a couple of days tomorrow.
Okay.
I'm visiting from Reston, Virginia.
I'm sorry, I can't see. I have only like one person on the screen for reasons I do not know. So please tell me who you are. Please tell me who's speaking.
Bruce Edgerton.
Bruce Edgerton.
Welcome.
Hey, welcome,
Bruce.
Welcome, Bruce.
Yeah, hi.
Hi, Bruce.
Okay, Bruce, where are you going again?
I'm visiting Berkeley from Reston, Virginia.
Oh.
Woo!
Traveling back home tomorrow.
Looks like you're in a church right now.
Yeah, I was hoping you guys were in person today, but.
Oh, well.
So I'm on the steps. It's a beautiful day to be on the steps.
Oh, my goodness.
I thought I recognized that stained glass window over the door, but I thought you were indoors somewhere.
Well, welcome, Bruce. Welcome to us.
We're sorry we're not there.
Yeah, you're just but we're glad you're here or there. Okay, anyway, any more travelers, people?
April's traveling to pick me up. This is it, Anne. April, my daughter's traveling Thursday to pick me up.
Okay.
And so then you are going somewhere.
I'm going down south for a little bit.
So you're traveling.
I'm going down to April's house.
Wow. Oh, good. Well, good, yeah. Anne. Great. Yeah. Anybody else? Okay. How about any anniversaries of any kind?
Yes.
Louise and I celebrated our 34th wedding anniversary yesterday.
Woo! Oh, wonderful.
Congratulations.
Thanks. Mm-hmm. Was that, I'm sorry, I can't quite see.
The Kearns.
So Rick and Louise.
Louise and Rick.
That was Rick.
Thanks. Erickson Kearns.
Okay. I don't know. Sometimes I have this screen, I only see myself. Other times another face pops up. I don't quite get it.
But. Did you click on gallery? On the gallery
view? Becky, not helpful.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
My instructions now, please. Other anniversaries, please, of any kind. All right. Let's do the birthday prayer first. Oh God, our times are in your hand. Look, we pray, look with favor, we pray, on your servants, Nicholas, Ruth, David, Judy, Duke, April, and Henry, as they begin another year. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace. Strengthen their trust in your goodness all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And our travelers, O God, our Heavenly Father, whose glory fills the whole creation and whose presence we find wherever we go, preserve those who travel, especially Margaret and Peter, Bruce, April, and Anne. Surround them with your loving care and protect them from every danger. Bring them in safety to their journey's end. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. An anniversary for Louise and Rick. Father in heaven, we ask your blessings upon Rick and Louise as they celebrate the anniversary of their marriage. May they so love, honor, and cherish each other in faithfulness and patience, in wisdom and true godliness, that their home may continue to be a haven of blessing and peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is Sing a New Song Unto the Lord.
Joy, oh come before.
Almighty God, grant that your holy word, which has been proclaimed this day, may enter into our hearts through your grace, that it may produce in us the fruit of the Spirit for witness and service in the world, and to praise and honor of your name. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia. No postlude, just coffee hour.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Larry. That was wonderful.
Thank you.
It was such an it was so interesting the way you talked about saints. Just fascinating. I mean, saints are pretty interesting.
They are. I had a big education in saints since I grew up.
That's a
Catholic. Yes, you did. You know, starting with those great little martyrdom books, which the kids would look at it. Oh my God, look what happened to that guy. And, well, that's how they draw you in, right?
My poor grandson is named Sebastian. Remember him?
Yeah, I do remember Sebastian.
I actually was thinking hard about saints because Lilia, who is now 12, had her first communion.
Yeah.
This year, and hard pressed to think of what to give her as a gift, among other things, a box of chocolates in Mendocino, in which all the chocolates had flower symbols and were named for different saints.
Oh.
So I gave this to her as an occasion to write a little note about saints and why Santa Rosa of Lima was important, or Saint Anthony of Padua, who always has a lily, or, you know, they all have symbols. And what is so interesting, which we have when we do morning prayer, because Lori reads us the saint of the day, is in every case, we have made the saints a model of the Christian life, a model for behavior. Whereas people like your mother and my wonderful mother-in-law live in a world filled with saints who are there helping you and active and engaging and intercessing. And it's a full, and you know, it's not my world, but I find it fascinating.
Yeah.
And you know that world, Larry.
I do. Yeah, I really do.
Larry, I'm curious. Did you grow up Catholic? I mean, Roman Catholic?
I did.
As you mentioned about the saints, and I think they have more emphasis on saints than we do, maybe.
I think maybe I do. I do think about saints. I mean, not all the time. And I wonder what they were really like. And I can only imagine that they had their bad moments. I mean, they could be bitch and nasty. And then I said, well, you know, we're all kind of saints. Well, at least I can certainly be peevish and nasty. But what Barbara Metcalf said is also important. For a lot of people I grew up with, the saints were really living presences. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And they were both models and people who lived with you, mm-hmm. as it were. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it was quite interesting. Quite interesting.
But while they were living, they didn't know they were saints.
No.
Isn't that true?
My guess. Yeah. I mean,
so they felt as though they were just ordinary people.
Yeah,
it must have been a big surprise.
Hey, what's going on?
I mean, when they realized they were closer to God than perhaps other people were. That must have been shocking to them, because they probably just thought they were ordinary people.
I think so.
Until something happened. So we all have that possibility.
I had occasion to do a deep dive into the letters of Vincent de Paul.
Yeah.
It's a wonderful, I guess it was a conversation he was having with a man who had done a lot of terrible crimes. And this man was, I forget what he was trying to do, but he was trying to find a missing child, I think. And he had to search in, terrible places for her. And he wasn't sure he was going to be successful because, he was this bad man. Why would God help him? And DePaul says to him something like, do you think the armies of God are made up of people who only have beatific smiles and halos over their head? That's kind of what he says. These are people who oftentimes know the grittiest of streets, mm-hmm. exactly where the devil hides. Something mm-hmm. like that. So he kind of says, you have everything you need to do the task and just go and do what you are called to do. I thought that was so modern in a way.
Yeah.
I think he spoke in those terms.
Yeah.
We have that hymn too about the saints and about how I want to be one too, That's one of the lines of it. And I think it's a great hymn.
Well, I think we are.
Mm-hmm.
I think we are, and we just don't know it. And I always think about what's her name? Saint Teresa of Avila. She's like one of my faves. And she was like very, she wrote a lot of books about prayer and divine experience, I guess you would say. But she traveled. She administered this whole bunch of convents. She was like a working woman. And I find that so interesting because I think that's what our lives are like.
Right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Actually, one of my faves is Brother Lawrence. Who really, his job in the monastery was, he was a cook.
Yeah, he was a cook.
And he was clattering around in his pots and pans. And that's when he was in touch with God.
Yeah.
So it's like this concept of sainthood is a capacity, a profound capacity accessible to this precious human gift. A stretch into that. I mean, we all have these moments of where we can rise to something much more transcendent than our own petty. And that touches on it. It's so wonderful to be reminded of that, that we carry that. That's our inheritance in a way. Mm-hmm. And it is beautiful and beatific. So thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And it's really there in the calendar of saints that we mm-hmm. have as Episcopalians, because, there are people that may have just had one great moment, really. Like, remember that trio of civil rights workers, Andrew somebody? Mm-hmm. We remember them every year.
Mm-hmm.
And this was a young white idealist mm-hmm. who is killed by Ku Klux Klan members.
Mm-hmm.
And, as I say, he was probably a really great kid, but he was, not unlike people we know, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Good turn. Apart right. from the St. Sebastians, who also turn up.
Yeah.
Well, I think most of us here probably came of age when the civil rights movement was going on in the South. And we look back and it seems so strange. But the whole struggle was over right of a person with darker skin to vote or to use the same water fountain. And if they didn't agree to that, they would get killed.
Yeah.
It seems so peculiar looking back on it.
Not really.
Well, lucky me, I get to write the write-up for the newsletter.
Good.
Well, we had a
which I'm going to do right now, folks.
So. Okay.
Good to be with all you saints.
Yeah. Good to be with all you saints.
Stay tuned for training.
Good week, everybody.
Bye. Bye-bye. Have a great week. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
And I hope the new year goes well for you.
Everyone.
I'm glad to see your face. Yeah.
Hi, Becky. Yeah.
Hi, Ann. You're going to be able to join us when you're at April's, do you think?
Oh, yes.
Okay, yeah. Good. We'll see.
Believe me, they have a system all set up. They set up in their living room. I'm in my spare bedroom, and we're all with our various churches.
Excellent. All right, we'll see you next. We'll see you next Sunday. Then have a
yes, thank you.
Have a safe.
My battery is running low.
Oh, okay. All right. Bye bye.
Bye bye, dear. Thank you.